the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty.
Amen.
Amen. When I came in this evening, Rick was having a go at me about not having a Christmas tree up. And he was telling me all about his Christmas trees, lots of them. Well, hallelujah for him. And, but one thing he said to me, which was out of context with everything else he said to me, he says, I really enjoy coming to Friday night. And then we changed the subject again. Why did he say that? Well, he's prophetic, that's why. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18b to 20, I'm going to have to be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, that's what I wanted to say. That's a scripture that has been with me ever since I was a little boy. And I can't play an instrument, but I love to sing and I love to worship. And when my wife comes up here on a Friday night and she comes home all excited and wakes me up and tells me all about the wonderful things that are happening. And then I say, well, this is what I've done. Usually, you know, Monday to Thursday night, by 8 o'clock I'm asleep on the couch. But Friday night, I enjoy just to have the house to myself and my stereo system. And I put on some worship songs and I just have my time with the Lord. Which is my quiet time, although it's probably a loud one. And I enjoy that. And what I've learned is that when we worship, I can worship how I want. There's no one's going to disturb me. I can pray in tongues, I sing in tongues, I can dance if I want. Mm-hmm. And then I may go asleep, I may not, I don't know. All sorts of things happen, but the peace of the Lord comes, which is great. And I've learned that through doing that on a Friday, it brings peace to me, and it also brings brings healing, I suppose. It calms my world down from a busy week, and it's like we mount up as eagles, you know, and we can then fly, and we find rest, and then it sort of sets me up for the weekend, for a great weekend. And so I just wanted to say that. But there is one other thing that I love just as much as singing and worshipping, and that's the communion. And I've said this before, I love communion ever since I was a kid. I enjoy it for all sorts of different reasons. But, you know, I've really, as an adult, I've come to really appreciate what the communion table is about and how important it is. So I'd just like to say, just think on the Lord, the things that he's done for you this week, this year, the things he's done for your family this week, this year, and thank him for that, that the sacrifice he made and that we celebrate at this communion time is because of that sacrifice he made, that we are able to be redeemed and we are able to just basically live. We are able to live. We're free to be healed. We're free to live as we want. And we're able to rejoice and pray and sing and do all the things we do. And so as you come to the communion table, and just think on these things.
Amen. Amen. You are my rock, you are
You know, the songs that Avi and Chris picked tonight are songs in some way of previous revivals that we've experienced over the years. And like some of those songs, the one from Isaiah, We See the Lord, just really wonderful songs and wonderful memories. Because the first time I heard that, I was in New Zealand at a John Wimber conference. And Andy Park, who wrote that song, sang it there. And at the same time, they had a girl in the congregation who was a rhythmic dancer who, as she came down the aisle, she'd throw ribbons right up to the ceiling, like metres and metres, and they'd sort of float down. She'd do a turn and then catch one behind her back. And I hadn't seen that before, and I haven't seen it since, but it was really profound. And we come here tonight and we're asking God to sort of speak to us. Now, there's a prerequisite on that, is when he speaks to you, you got to do what he tells you. That's why in the scripture he says, those, if today you hear his voice, don't harden your heart. Don't harden your heart. And he says over and over, he who has ears, let him hear what the Spirit is saying. Now, we wouldn't be encouraged with that if it wasn't possible. When we're worshipping, Cole, the Spirit of God said to me that you can get tired of doing repetitive things, but he doesn't get tired of it. And what you're doing, which seems to be little or insignificant, if you look at the other side, you are doing things that in the glory of God are very significant. And you need to be open to different ways that God can speak to you, because God will not let you put him in a box. And he wants to increase and increase and increase the revelation that he gives you. I speak salvation and healing over your family in the name of Jesus. We speak into the Spirit for things that we cannot see to become things that we can.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. And Bob, when you're around at your house and you've got ways of doing things, you know, and you're a man who's quite set in his ways, and that's a good thing, because that means that you've been very faithful. But God says there has to be ways in which he can teach you new ways. Because in these, the golden years of your life, you're never going to be used by God as much as you are now. This is it for you. This is the time when in some ways your apprenticeship is finished. And God is going to use you mightily. Because along the way, you have learnt some lessons that are really important to people who haven't learnt them yet. God's going to bring people along your path. You're not going to have to struggle for a ministry. There'll be a ministry waiting for you. And in the worship, Rick, I saw you. And it's almost like you've got a well of pain in you that's so deep that almost can't be touched. And you think that somehow God's going to rip the scabs off or rip the band-aids off, but that's not how he's going to treat you. He's going to overwhelm you with his love. And when you open to him, then you're going to find all this junk that's been around for years is going to just ooze out, and you're going to be healed. And you're going to be amazed. You're going to find yourself crying with no explanation for the tears, except you're going to know that they're different to what you have been crying, because they'll be tears of liberation. And you'll know after it, you won't feel drained and immobilised, but you'll feel empowered. God has his hand on you. He's been waiting for you for many years. And he's put you in a place where he's going to heal you of these things that often you don't even recognise, because they become part of the weave and woke of your life. You don't recognise it often, except just to know that there's pain there. I speak liberty to you and freedom in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to speak tonight on the bread of life, and it's a communion talk, it's not done at communion. So, you know, Jesus comes and says, I'm the bread of life. And we know that he wants us to be eating fresh manna. That's why the example he gave us in the Bible, if you left it a day, it was no good. Now, in growing up, one of the things that we were able to have without too much restriction was bread. And there used to be a bit of a fight on in the afternoon to who's going to get the crust. Because if you took the crust from each end, it made the bread pretty hard to cut. It took the stability away. But it was also nice with veggie or peanut butter or jam or whatever you had on it. One of my favourites was golden syrup.
Yeah. Yum. Yeah.
And
all the prophets said.
And when I was praying about tonight, and Jesus wants you to be someone who produces something, who's not just a consumer. So much of the church is based on consumerism rather than what we're producing to a sighing, dying world. And I'm reminded, Jesus invites us when he instituted communion that we would eat of his flesh and drink of his blood. In fact, he said to his disciples, you won't have life in you if you don't do that. And so we need to make sure that when we come to have communion, we're looking for a life encounter. And I'm reminded of the amount of trouble and the examples that God has shown us in the animal kingdom. How much substance he puts on food that he wants to feed. You take the emperor penguin. The emperor penguin and the biggest penguins. And they live miles from the sea. And they live in the Arctic. So they're living in very inhospitable conditions. And there's hundreds of thousands of them all together. And they find a nesting site where they lay an egg on the ground. And then pick it up in their feet and put it up under themselves. And each day, a different one of them, or each couple of days, will make the journey to the ocean, dive in, and go be away for a couple of days catching fish that they bring home, walk a couple of miles from the beach up the hill, and then regurgitate the food for the right chick. And when you have a look, you wouldn't know how they find the right chick, because they're like an ocean of penguins. And all sorts of animals feed their young by taking food for their young and regurgitating it. Jesus wants us to take his body and blood, to take the communion elements and let them be assimilated into our body. So however long it takes, we imbibe it and it goes into us and changes us. And often we miss the point that Jesus is trying to produce in us his life, a different way of being him to the world. He says to us, the kingdom is within you. The kingdom's within you. So that means, Barney, I'm not repeating myself, but if you didn't pick it up, you're not going to get it. That's it. Jesus doesn't move sideways like a crab. I think a lot of Christians can move sideways like a crab and not go forward. And we're meant to go forward. And would not mean, if you like, communion's not an act in isolation. Common union. It's something that's meant to bring us together. And Jesus wants you to come from being a spiritual consumer to a spiritual producer. Is that right?
Yes. Hallelujah.
It could be nice. Yeah. One of the things that I have been studying and praying into is the whole area of quantum physics. And quantum physics, I believe, are really a revelation of what God's capable of. One fact that you probably might know is that for a fraction in time, you disappear. So even though you're sitting here, you're not here all the time. You slip in and out. Now, they don't know where you go, right? But you're not here. But if we, so that means if we were to put a camera on Rick and we were to slow it down enough, we'd be able to see him flick in and out of the chair. And somewhere within the glory of God, there's a tremendous power available to the church. And I believe we're just starting to see it. And there's a tremendous creative power in words. And one of the reasons why I share stories of what I've seen is because I'm looking forward to what I will see. I'm looking forward to Frank and Lynn Cox, you may know, who used to go to Box Hill all the time, and I see them now and again. They were in a church in South Australia when a curtain of gold started to fall down between the worship team and the congregation. Now, they haven't seen it since, but they saw it once. So what's there is there to be seen by others. I've been in places when we have been where flecks of gold dust or flecks of gold-like material appeared over everyone's face and their clothes and their grin and the ground and all of that. And I think that sometimes you don't cherish those things and they pass on. See, what's the point in you praying for the sick if you don't carry the power to see them get better? Are we meant to just be seeing how people are? Here's Susie Perkins, Miracle Lady, sitting there tonight. Okay? And I think she's looking pretty good. And yet she has been through some really big health challenges. Really big ones. See, we say, don't we? A lot of people say seeing is believing, but I can tell you what. I can tell you a lot of people see and they don't believe in spite of what they've seen. When we're talking today about, from John chapter 6, it tells the story of the multiplication of the loaves and fishes. Tanya and I have seen that dozens and dozens and dozens of times. And we haven't seen it for a few years, but we haven't been in a place where we put ourselves on the edge, where we were preaching a message that was bigger than in our own lives. Miracles offer the heart of decision. We have to live between miracles, because we don't want to be like Thomas, doubting Thomas, where he said, unless I see the wounds. If I don't see the wounds, I'm not going to believe. And we're living in a time where I believe that God is winding up history, being wound up in front of our eyes. We see things happen where we see persecution of the Christian church in our own day, in our own nation. This is supposedly a Christian nation. Well, I think it's becoming a woke nation. And we are seen as being strange because we believe in the supernatural. We believe in what we can't see. They're all concerned at the miracle of loaves and fishes with how they were going to feed the people. But in the midst of them was the bread from heaven. He's there. And we're here tonight, and he's here with us, because he said he would be. He said, where you're gathered in my name, I'll be there right in the midst of you. So we need to reverence his presence. You need to stop looking for yesterday's manna. God has told me that we will see fresh manna in our midst. I don't know when, but he's told me it'll happen. He told me people are going to open their Bible and see manna sitting there. He's going to do that. I put it on tape. There it is. Play it to my enemies. You need to stop looking for yesterday's manna. I'm not going to tell you how good it was 20 years ago or 30 years ago or 40 years ago. But I'm telling you, good times are with us and in front of us.
Amen.
Yes.
And Jesus needed to get them to look inside to see that what they were believing is actually eternal. That this kingdom of heaven is within us. And it's not abracadabra and things change. It's the miracle power of God is moving with these people. See, David's there tonight sharing our Friday night. He has time with God. Now, David didn't share with us, did you notice? He didn't have to worry about whether God had turned up or not. He just has to be concerned about whether he's going to turn up. If he's going to turn up, if he's going to work within the parameters that God is showing him about revelation, and then what's he going to do with what's revealed? We need to fill our bellies with Jesus. The very fabric of our life needs to be intertwined with him. Manna came fresh every morning, but they had to go and collect it. His mercies, the Bible tells us, are new every morning. You need a fresh word from God every day of your life. And sometimes you need a fresh word a few times a day. And so when Jesus said, I'm the bread of life, unless you eat of my flesh and drink of your blood, the disciples thought, well, this is a hard word. And Peter said, and the disciples left him. Great number left him. And he said, are you going too? And they said, you alone have the word of life. You need to hear that deep within your spirit, that he alone has the word of life. Tonight, God could speak to you during the worship, during the preaching, just during the fellowship and the interaction with people, God can speak to you. See, Dave's talking about the fact he has a conversation with Rick, and in the middle of that conversation, God chose to highlight some things to Dave and speak to him. But it's all about him. See, an old saying that I've lived my life by, that yesterday's history and tomorrow's a mystery. You've got to travel light without lots and lots of baggage with you. And you can take baggage every day. People can put it on you. You can put it on yourself. The devil will put it on you. And you can be burdened every day. You can start off going well, and by lunchtime you're like a pack horse. You've got all this stuff, all this accusation on you. Being a believer means we hear from God today. It's a daily discipline of looking for the manna. Some of us find ourselves in the corner, not realising always that God has put us there. Because he wants it done his way. And surrender is easy to say, but not always easy to do. See, God wants us to be on a restricted diet. Low carb, low sugar, high bread of life. He wants us to be eating the eternal life. In Hebrews it says, without faith it's impossible to please God. When we pick up those communion elements, there's a faith that God is encouraging us to have, that this is not just a little packet of bread and juice, but it's more than that. It's an eternal reality that we're eating. It's something that some things where we profit from something that's so mystical and so wonderful. There's a mixing that goes on within us, so that however long it is after we've taken the elements, they've disappeared into our body. They've disappeared from our gastric juices, but they've done something to us. We come to God as a volitional, sacrificial act. And we need to test our hearing all the time. And one way you'll know if you're hearing God, or you've done anything about it. Are you hearing from God and acting? As it says in John 10:10, my sheep hear my voice and they obey. Obedience is a word that's not easy to actually work our way through, because we want our own way and we see things our own way. In the Victorian state elections, there's a young girl there who declared that she wants to put all her decisions through her Christian faith. They threw her out. Hey? Unbelievable. Then they found out they couldn't throw her out, because she's been elected by the people now, so they're going to have to struggle with what they do with her. It's a good sort of struggle, really. But don't think that in the Victorian Liberal Party that she's the only Christian. Plenty, hundreds and thousands of Christians in that party. But that's what that happened to her. What they say, evil triumphs when good men and women do nothing. I'm going to get Colleen to play a bit of music by John Michael Talbot. John Michael Talbot was quite a famous pop star. He became a Christian. Now he runs an order, Protestant order of Franciscans. And it was I've met him. The church I was in brought him to Australia. He just walked out at the Horde Pavilion, sat in a chair and sounded just like his records, him and a guitar and a female backing singer. And this is one of his songs on communion about Jesus being the bread of life. And I pray for you that you would know the truth of that. you would know the truth of that. Not because I said it, maybe even said it badly, but you would know the truth of that. You would know that Jesus saying, eat me, be me. And that I pray that you'll be touched in the deep places by the hand of God. Animals into being. He spoke us into being. He has spoken our children into being. This God wants to speak to you in a way where you'll be able to share the gospel with insight and with power. And it's been my privilege over many years to be able to know things about people that only God could tell me. And the people know that I don't know. I don't know them, so when you speak a prophetic word unto someone, they encounter heaven in some way. And I want to encourage you because God wants to really, really get to us so that we can use what he's given us to use. We can't do anything, you know, without God doing it to us. So I pray for you. I pray for the burdens you're carrying that you go away with them lighter tonight. I pray you'd know how much you're loved by God, how special you are. And I pray that the glory of the Lord would be upon you. And in that glory, you would be empowered to do what he asks you to do. Amen.